Hello, everyone. It's time to start our session in which Shimshon, Bichler and Jonathan Nitzan's paper is going to be presented. I'm not sure whether I need to present who Jonathan Nitzan and Shimshon Bichler are, but because most of you would know very well, personally or directly, indirectly, know him very well, but there are some people who might not know, not be very friendly with, with who he is. So I am just giving you some basic facts about who Jonathan Nitzan is. He was born in Israel and he immigrated to Canada in early 1980s. And he pursued his academic degrees in McGill universities. And it was 1992 that he got PhD from the economics department in McGill University. After that, he worked in a financial institution as an analyst of political economy for some years. And he began to teach political economy in York University since 1998. And he and his very close co-worker, Shimshon Bichler, they collectively have developed a new methodology of political economy and social theory in general, which has produced the capital as power framework. And his major works include the Global Political Economy of Israel that came out in 2002, and Capital as Power that came out in 2009. Most of his papers and articles and books are available in this archive, this website, the Bichler and Nitzan Archive. So today he and Shimshon Bichler is presenting a paper titled A Capital as Power Model of the Stock Market. Unfortunately, we don't have Shimshon Bichler here, but I believe he is going to be with us in his mind. So, without further ado, let me introduce Jonathan Nitzan here.
Okay, thank you very much, Gibbon, for a very generous introduction. Before I begin, those of you who prefer to look at the charts electronically, you can just go to the Bichler and Nitzan archives, and it's publication number 489, and the chart book that you have in print is also there electronically. And those of you who do not have a physical paper chart book, there are, I believe, more copies on the desk at the end of the room. So, the purpose of my presentation today is to sketch a CASP model of the stock market, and there are two reasons why I think such a model is needed. The first reason is that the stock market has become the main compass, we believe, of the capitalist mode of power. And the second reason is the unfortunate reason that so far we have not developed a model to describe it. Now, surprising as it may sound, all long-term modeling of the stock market derives from a single meta-dogma that Shimshon and I have dubbed the mismatch thesis. The basic premise of this dogma is the bifurcation between economics and politics, and the further division within economics between the real and nominal spheres. Finance in this dogma is viewed as a symbolic nominal mirror that reflects the underlying real economy. But this reflection, and here we come to the key point, is imperfect. So financial magnitudes tend to mismatch reality. And the purpose of a stock market model is to explain this mismatch and predict its consequences. Now, our own CASP model begins not by negating the findings and predictions of the mismatch thesis, but by giving them what we believe to be a totally different interpretation. So our model argues that underneath the economic veneer of the standard model lies a power process, and that this power process, rather than productivity and utility, drive the stock market. This alternative interpretation, I think, is important for at least three reasons. The first reason is that it gives rise to questions that conventional political economy and the conventional theories the mismatch thesis are really unable to ask because of their disposition. Secondly, it leads to findings that end up contradicting both mainstream and heterodox political economy, in our opinion. And thirdly, it might open the door for a better understanding of how the capitalist mode of power operates and how it might be resisted. So the presentation that I will give today consists, as they say in the army, of three parts. First, I will begin with a bird's eye overview of the stock market over more or less the past 200 years. And I will try to identify the quantitative regularities of the stock market, or at least some of the important ones, as well as the qualitative processes that we believe transform and, in so doing, drive the quantitative appearance of the stock market. So after doing that, I will move to explain the mainstream mismatch thesis. And specifically, I will describe the valuation model of John Hussman. You probably never heard of John Hussman, and the reason we chose this particular model of the many models that exist is because, to the best of our knowledge, it offers the best prediction of long-term returns on the stock market. So it is kind of the Maserati of all valuation models. After doing that, the last part of the presentation is trying to do the impossible, maybe, and offer a triangular CASP model. And I'm using here, perhaps metaphorically, the impossible triangle that was generated by Penrose, the mathematician. And I will try to substantiate three claims. First, I'll try to show that we can reproduce John Hussman's results by looking not at the utilitarian underpinnings of production and consumption as the driver of the stock market, but directly on capitalized power. So that's the first thing I'd like to substantiate. Secondly, I'll try to explore how capitalized power is dialectically intertwined with what we call systemic fear. And thirdly and finally, I'll try to illustrate that the driving force that stands behind both capitalized power and systemic fear is strategic sabotage. And in this regard, I will examine how economic policy has been, over the past century, deeply integrated into the CASP-driven stock market, and perhaps speculate a little bit on what that might mean for the future. Now, the principles that we deal with seem to us quite general, but this being really a pilot project and something that emerged kind of on a fly from some discussions that we had, and we didn't really intend to go in that direction. As a consequence of that, our empirical analysis is quite limited, and for the time being is just focused on the United States. But it seems that this kind of an approach can be applied relatively easily to other countries. So it's kind of inviting replication in other settings. Now, I will speak for slightly more than an hour. So obviously, I cannot offer here more than a skeleton of our argument. We hope to be putting together a long article or short book on the subject I don't know, in the next weeks and months. But we will have a fairly extended question and answer period, so hopefully some of the themes that I'm touching upon we can unzip a little further after I finish. So let me begin with the first figure, figure one, and some of the details in the figures might not be exactly clear when you look in the overhead, but you can see them in the paper copies as well as on the PDF if you are watching it directly on your computer. So this chart has two panels, and in each panel you have two series, one thin line and the other is a thick line. So let me begin with the top panel with a thin line. This line shows you the U.S. stock price in constant dollars since the late 18th century. Now, what that means is that for every year, the nominal stock price index is divided by the CPI. And economists go through this division in order to show stock prices in what they call real terms. And what they mean by real terms essentially is purchasing power. So each reading on this thin line shows you the purchasing power denominated in utils of the owners of the largest US-based firms, because I'm focusing here on the S&P 500. So these are the largest firms listed in the United States. So for example, if the thin line rises by 10%, that means that owners like Buffett or Soros, when they go to the supermarket, they can buy 10% more groceries, or that they can spend 10% more on fuel for their automobiles. Or if the index drops by 30%, that means that the Buffetts and the Soroses of this world can afford maybe 30% less clothing, or they can spend 30% less on childcare. Now, there is probably another interpretation that might be more meaningful when we think about this computation. Notice that when we divide stock prices by the CPI, essentially we are computing a ratio. We are computing a ratio between the prices of two baskets. One basket comprises the 500 largest stocks in the stock market, and the other basket comprises all consumer goods and services. So if we think of relative commodity prices as reflecting the relative power of the owners of those baskets, then what we measure here is not only purchasing power, but also differential power. So the owner, the power of those who own stocks relative to the power of those who own consumer goods and services. They might be the same people occasionally, but in principle, they are two distinct categories. So we have here, in fact, two measures in one. We have purchasing power, and we have differential power. And what I would like to do now is focus only on differential power as opposed to purchasing power. So what does this chart tell us? Well, first, it shows that over the past 200 years or so, differential power, the power of stock owners relative to the power of owners of consumer goods and services, has risen exponentially. So notice that we're using here a logarithmic scale, so equal distances represent multiples of 10. And you can see that throughout this period, the average or the mean growth rate of stock prices in constant dollars was 2.71%. Now that might seem like a small number, but if you compound it over a period of 215 years, you end up with a 313-fold increase in the relative power of stock owners. So that's quite significant. Now, the bottom panel of the series deals with rates of change. So for every year, the thin line in this chart shows you the growth of US stock prices in constant dollar relative to the previous year. And as you can see here, the mean value is 2.71%, exactly the number that I mentioned before. Now, each panel contains also a thick line. And in the top, this series represents a 10-year centered average. What that means is that each observation on the fixed series represents an average of a window of 10 years. So if you're in the middle of the window, you take the 5 years from your perspective, 5 years prior to the window to the point of observation and 5 years after, and you sum those numbers and you divide by 10. So you get a 10-year centered average. And we do the same thing at the bottom for rates of change. Now, this thick line is useful in describing what we call major bear markets, or MBMs. In a market whose differential prices tend upwards over time, and you can see it has increased 313-fold, the most dramatic, even spectacular event is a protracted crash, or what we call a major bear market. And we define a major bull market as a period that fulfills two criteria. The first criteria is that 10-year centered average goes downward. And the second criteria is that every annual peak is lower than the previous peak. So a major bull market can go this way. The trend is still downward, but there is a cyclical movement, and every annual peak is below the previous one. So if we use this dual definition and we start counting the shaded areas, we can count 7 distinct major bear markets. We have 3 in the beginning of the 19th century. We have 3 during the 21st century. And the last one is in the beginning of the 21st century. And these major bear markets are summarized in table 1. Now, when the market is booming, the popular media loves to insist that this time is different. So the talking heads on the television would tell you that something fundamental has changed, and from now on, the good times can roll on forever. This point, for example, was made in 1928 by the famous economist Irvin Fisher, just a short historical while before he lost his great fortune, equivalent to $100 million in today's prices, to the stock market crash of 1929. And experience is not a very good teacher, because in 1999, a few other experts predicted that the stock, or claimed that the stock market, was significantly undervalued and it is going to triple in price in just 5 years. And they made that prediction exactly before the stock market crashed and fell by a half. Now, the experts on the subject of finance, mostly academics, love to ridicule this kind of common sense thing that appears in the popular media. And they use expressions such as irrational exuberance, or they write books with titles that read, "This time is different," with kind of quotation marks. And what they're saying is essentially very simple. They said, look, the market has its own natural mean reverting pattern, and there is nothing anyone can do about it. And this point is illustrated by the following chart, which essentially magnifies the bottom part of the previous one. So figure 2 is taken from the bottom part of figure 1. And what we do in this figure is we eliminate the yearly observations and stick only with the 10-year centered average. And we can see here 3 regularities, maybe more, but 3 we can easily mention and everyone can see. First, the growth rate of the market is not some sort of an even series. It's not that the market grows every year or the moving average is sort of fixed. What we see is that the growth market oscillates around the mean. So it's mean reverting. So that's one regularity. The second regularity is that the mean reversion is not erratic. It's not a random series that just goes up and down with no pattern. It's cyclical. So it has a stylized pattern. And the cycle itself is actually quite regular. It has a fairly stable duration. So the duration is not fixed, but it's not completely erratic. And it has a certain amplitude, which is illustrated here by marking 1 and 2 standard deviation below and above it, above the average. So on the whole, it seems that the market does follow some sort of a naturally reoccurring process, or at least it looks like it. But is it? I suggest that we notice that during the past 100 years or so, every major bear market was followed by a major reordering of the of capitalized power and in a significant rewriting of the capitalist nomos. So let me just mention these three transformations. The first major bear market of the turn of the 20th century, so that's 1905 to 1920, was followed by the rise of corporate capitalism. So that was the first reordering. Then the second major bear market, which took place from the late 20s to the late 1940s, was followed by the rise of Keynesianism and the welfare state. And the third MBM of the 20th century, from 1960 to 1981, was followed by the rise of global neoliberalism. So these are three major transformations that are taking place underneath those regularities. Now, in this regard, the first major bear market of the 21st century, from 1999 to 2008, seems incomplete, to us at least. The capitalist system seems to be rattling in recent years. However, it might take another major bear market to bring about a significant reordering of the nature that we observed in the three previous MBMs of the 20th century. Now, the key thing about these reorderings is that they are qualitatively different from each other. So we perhaps can, in the end, say that this time, like every other time, is both similar and different. The similar quantities of power are driven by different qualities of power. So that would be a first observation that perhaps we can draw from this pattern. Now, how do we make sense of this long-term quantitative-qualitative pattern? The common and perhaps only theory is what Shimshon and I have called the mismatch thesis that I've already mentioned. Now, according to this thesis, capitalism is a mode of production and consumption that can be described and analyzed in real terms. In other words, hedonic units of utility, or what Irving Fisher called utils. So when economists say that the economy has grown by 5%, what they mean, whether they acknowledge it or not, is that the economy produced 5% more utils this year than it produced last year. So that's the real sphere of the economy. But the economy has another sphere, a financial sphere. And that sphere is denominated not in real terms, but in symbolic units of dollars and cents. And the stock market is part of this financial sphere, in fact, the central part of this financial sphere, and it has a crucial role. It acts as a giant mirror that reflects what happens in the real sphere. Or more accurately, it reflects what will happen in the real sphere. We're talking about finance. Now, how does this mirror work? So according to the mismatch thesis, which can be traced, like many things in economics, to Irving Fisher, capitalists own machines. Let me just get this thing. Capitalists own machines, they own raw materials, and their own knowledge plus a lot of chemicals, which they mix together, and we can call this the capital stock. And they own this real capital stock here and now. So we are in the current period, and capitalists own real capital stock. Why do they own this real capital stock? Well, ostensibly, in order to produce income services in the future. So we're moving from the present to the future. We're still in the real term, in the real world. The capital stock here specifically would produce in the future corn syrup. And why will capitalists produce corn syrup? Because they expect to be able to sell those future income services in return for profit. So we are still in the future, but instead of real income services, we have a nominal magnitude of profit. So we move to the nominal sphere. Now, capitalists do not wait all the way to the deep future. They think about the future now, and they capitalize those expected future earnings, and they have the value of those future earnings as a form of capitalization. So we are now back to the present in nominal terms. So there are a lot of transformations here. And if these transformations are all perfectly accurate, we have a match. But if they are not perfectly accurate, we have a mismatch. So let's look at this process a little bit more closely. And most of you would recognize probably equation one. And this equation simply explains the way we see how capitalists operate. And what capitalists do essentially is they look into the future and they say, we want to capitalize the earnings in the future. So the E in this equation is the actual future earnings that will be earned and that capitalists want to discount. But the future is unknown and unknowable. So capitalists cannot know what E is right now. They might know in the future if they live forever. So they guesstimate the future. And if they are very accurate, then their estimate is going to be exactly what will happen. But most of the time, they're not accurate. If they're overly optimistic, then they will overestimate those earnings. So we introduce a coefficient called H for hype. And that coefficient will be bigger than one if they are overhyped, overly optimistic. If they are conversely overly pessimistic, this H is going to be less than one. Then they take those expected earnings and discount them to present value by dividing it by some discounting factor. And the discounting factor itself is composed of two components. One is the normal rate of return, which capitalists expect to earn if there is no risk to their future outlook. And another coefficient that says, well, we're not sure about our expectations, so therefore we are going to introduce a coefficient that is going to, in our opinion, account for our uncertainty. We call that delta, and that will be a risk coefficient. In this case, it's a risk of equities, say, relative to fairly secure investments, as is 30-year US government bonds. Now, the problem with equation one is that earnings are very volatile. They change from year to year, and they're very, very difficult to deal with, especially on an expectational basis. So it is really convenient to take a shortcut. So we're moving to equation two. And what that this shortcut usually entails is that the capitalist or analyst would say, well, instead of earnings, let's do the following. Let's look at gross value added here and now, or GDP. And we know that profit is a share of this gross value added. And since we're interested in profit all the way to the deep future, let's think of a certain number, say 6%, that on average, profit will be 6% of GDP, sometimes more, sometimes less, but that will be the long-term average. So that's one thing that we need to take into account. The other thing we need to take into account is the growth rate of GDP or gross value added itself. So if we have the growth rate of GDP and the share of profit in GDP, then we have a sense of how much profit is going to grow in the future relative to gross value added right now. So these two components, the share of profit in GDP and the growth rate of GDP, can be inserted into a single coefficient called M. If you multiply M by GVA, you have future profits. Now, of course, they don't know what this M is, and therefore they sometimes will overestimate it, sometimes they will underestimate it. So H really refers now to this M. The rest of the equation is the same. Now, the third step that I'm taking here is to say, let's take equation two and decompose it into two components. One is gross value added, which is relatively unambiguous and readily observable. We know what it is because it's being estimated, and there is some conventional agreement on what it is. And then there are other four coefficients that are packed into this product ratio, some of which are unknown, like M, and others which are kind of iffy and very kind of fluffy. Now, this decomposition is useful because it shows us the gist of the mismatch thesis. If the future were perfectly known, the four elements here would be a constant, because M is already a constant, because there is no uncertainty, the normal rate of return will probably be equal to the growth rate of gross value added. So 6% gross value added, 6% normal rate of return. And because there's no uncertainty, H and delta would be 1. So essentially, we'd have some sort of a fixed coefficient here. But the future is unknown and unknowable. So capitalists and analysts deal with the unknown. And the result is uncertainty, irrationality, distortions. And that means that this component will fluctuate. It will oscillate. Now, the uncertainty, irrationality, and distortions argue the advocates of the mismatch thesis, which is essentially everybody. Although these things are abound, they are not unbounded. The movement of this second element of the equation might have a large amplitude and might take a long time to complete, but it's mean reverting. And this mean reversion is the theoretical basis of all long-term valuation models. So let's see how these principles pan out in practice. My focus here is on the model of fund manager John Hussman, which, as I indicated, offers probably the best prediction of long-term returns on the stock market. So this figure plots the two components of Hussman's valuation model. These two series pertain to the United States, and they pertain to US-based non-financial corporations. Why non-financial? Because that model gave the best results. And both are denominated in current dollars, and both are plotted against logarithmic scales. The market capitalization, which is K in our equation, is a thick line, and gross value added is the dashed line. Now, as you can see, this figure, or this equation, this figure corresponds to the equation on the side, equation 3. So we have a series for K, we have a series for GVA, and the ratio of these two series is this component. So this is the basis for Hussman's valuation indicator, which is given next to figure 4. So HVI is Hussman valuation indicator. That's the name that we gave it. And it's a very simple ratio of market capitalization to gross value added. And if you divide market capitalization by gross value added, that's the equation number 5, what you get is this four-element component. Now, if you look at the chart on the right, figure 4, you see that indeed, Hussman's valuation indicator is bounded. It's mean reverting. It oscillates between a value of about 0.6, give or take, and a value of about 2.2, give or take. Now, why should all of this discussion be of any interest to anyone other than, you know, people who like to play with graphs? And the reason is the dashed line in the figure. Now, let me read you the definition. It seems long and complicated, but in fact, it's a very simple computation. The dashed line is forward annual nominal total return on the S&P 500 index over the next 12 years. So I'll explain what it means by an example. If you are a capitalist and you invest in the S&P 500 in the year 1984, then we have data for the next 12 years, and we can know now, looking back, how much money you as a capitalist made. And if we project this observation in the series to the right, we see that you made about 16% on average annually over the next 12 years. So that's something that we can compute. You take the observation 12 years later, so it's 84 plus 12 is 96. We divide the value of 96 by 84. We take the 12 root of it, and then subtract 1, multiply by 100. We get the average geometric mean of that period, and it turns out to be 16%. If you were to invest in 1999, we project this value to the right, and it turns out to be about 1%. So if you were investing in that peak year, you ended up making almost no money over the next 12 years. Now notice that investors who bought the S&P in 84 bought when the valuation indicator, Hussmann's valuation indicator, was very cheap, was 0.6, and they made a lot of money. And those who bought it when it was about 2.2 made basically no money. This axis is inverted. It starts from 28, and the numbers go down until they become negative. So what we see is that there is a very tight negative correlation between Hussmann's valuation indicator and subsequent long-term returns. In fact, the correlation is quite astounding. It's a negative 0.93%. In other words, knowing the ratio of gross market capitalization to gross value added now gives you insight deep into the future, which is incredibly accurate on how much money you can make investing in the stock market. So investors might not know what is going to happen next month or next year or the next couple of years, but they know pretty well what's going to happen over the next 12 years. Now, notice here, this is just a precursor for what is going to follow, that right now we're about here. So we don't know what investors investing now are going to make because we have to wait another 12 years. But if this model continues to hold, the situation is pretty dire. It could be summarized by three very famous words: winter is coming, right? So before I continue, though, two contrarian observations. First observation is the role of economic irrationality. So you see, conventional economics suggests that accumulation thrives on and drives economic rationality. But this figure seems to suggest the exact opposite, I think. Because the more irrational the investors, the greater the mismatch. In other words, the greater deviation of this index from its own average. And the greater the mismatch between the capitalization and the real underlying fundamentals, the greater the scope of accumulation. If you are buying the market here, you have a scope for a very large return. If you're shorting the market here, you also have an extended scope for large returns. So in fact, irrationality here seems to amplify the potential for accumulation. So that's kind of a disturbing finding that comes out of this apparent, very highly predictive model. The second problem has to do with the connection between risk and return. A finance textbook reiterate the Austrian economic mantra that risk and return should go hand in hand. But again, this figure seems to suggest rather the opposite. The greatest return are available when risk is minimal, like here. And the lowest return are available when risk is, in fact, very high. So again, this model seems to suggest something quite contrarian to conventional beliefs of finance and perhaps even of some economic theory. So this is the conventional cosmology of finance, really, in a nutshell. And what I'd like to do now is to turn it upside down and try to put it on its feet. So in the remaining of the presentation, I'll talk about our own CasP model of the stock market. And I will begin the analysis with capitalized power. I will then try to relate capitalized power to systemic risk. And finally, I'll try to tie the whole thing, this impossible triangle, together by looking at strategic sabotage. So let's begin with the inversion of Hussmann's mismatch index. So this chart shows you the mismatch index by Hussmann here. And it's presented by the dashed line against the right-hand scale. And it superimposes on this index another index, which we call the power index. And this is a very simple ratio. It's a ratio between the price of the S&P 500 and the average wage rate. Now, why do we call this a power index? Well, recall that Husman's index tries to match market capitalization, which essentially is the aggregate purchasing power of capitalists from a conventional viewpoint, and tries to match that purchasing power with the underlying fundamentals of the capitalization. What are the underlying fundamentals? Is what the real capital stock will produce in income services in the future that will be sold for profit. So this is what they're trying to do. They're trying to match two magnitudes, the consumption power with the production power of capitalists. Now, our own index is really very different on two counts. First, we do not look at the aggregate stock and the aggregate flow of things in the economy. We look just at prices. So it's a price, an average price of the stock market and an average price of the labor commodity. And secondly, not only do we look only on prices, these prices are totally different creatures. Unlike the numerator and the denominator of Husman's model, which are supposed to match each other, here there is no apparent connection. There need to be no connection between the price of stocks and the price of labor. They're not supposed to reflect one another. So there's no reason to match, and therefore there is no reason to mismatch. In fact, instead of mirroring each other, we argue that these two prices represent a conflict. They represent a clash between those who own the market and those who are controlled by the market. So when our index, our power index rises, it means that the power of equity owners rises relative to the power of the underlying population on average, and vice versa when the index declines. And yet, and this is really a fascinating point, although these are totally different creatures, they have nothing in common supposedly, empirically, they correlate almost perfectly. If you look here, the correlation between these two indices over the period in which they overlap is almost perfect. It's plus 0.96 out of a maximum of 1. So what is going on here? How is that at all possible? Well, to do that, let's look a little bit more closely on these figures. And you have here several equations, equations 6 to 10. And actually, they look complicated, but they're very, very simple. And if you were to go through these equations and you go all the way down to equation 6, you end up with something akin to what Gilbert Ryles called the ghost in the machine, the power ghost in the mismatch machine. It turns out, if you look at equation 10, and we amplify that in our paper to be completed, that what drives the mismatch index, in fact, is the quantified or capitalized conflict between capitalists and the underlying population. The power index is the main component, in fact, inside the mismatch index. And if individual irrationality has a role to play, it basically is no more than some sort of noise, some sort of an addition here at the end. So the 96% of the variations are accounted by power. And we call them mismatch, but in fact, it is about power. So in a sense, the mismatch thesis reminds us of the Ptolemaic geocentric view. See, the idea that the sun epicycles around the Earth yielded pretty accurate predictions, but it was wrong. And maybe we can say the same thing about the mismatch model. The idea that somehow capitalists try to match the underlying fundamentals of the economy yields pretty accurate predictions, but they might be actually barking up the wrong tree. They might have actually the wrong interpretation of what is going on underneath. So our argument is that the real driving force here is not mismatching future utility, but changes in organized power. That's the claim of equation 10. And figure 6 tries to illustrate that there is some water to this claim. What we show in this picture are two series you have already seen. We're only putting them together. So the first series is our power series, which is the ratio of the S&P 500 to the price of labor, to the wage rate. And that is plotted against the left-hand scale, and it's normalized. So the mean of the series is 100. And then we superimposed on this series the forward annual nominal total return on the S&P 500 index 12 years into the future. By the way, when I say total returns, that means capital appreciation plus dividends. So that's the meaning of total return, as opposed to just returns, which is kind of a vague term and can mean just either capital appreciation or dividends. So total return is this plus that. So we are imposing, superimposing these two indices, one on top of the other. And we are also including here a measure of variability. So you see one standard deviation below the mean of the power index and two standard deviations above it, so to give you a sense of oscillation. And we also shade the four major bear markets so you are better oriented historically. Now, what the chart shows you is that the correlation between our power index and future returns. So our power index now, rather than the mismatch index, is the predictor of future returns. And the prediction is pretty tight. It's almost negative 0.8 for the entire period since 1871. Now, obviously, if you inspect this picture visually, you see that the correlation is less tight up till 1929 than after. But the relevant period for comparison here is 1953 to 2004, which is the period of Hussmann's model. And the correlation we have here is negative 0.85 compared to negative 0.93 for Hussmann. So it's slightly lower than Hussmann's, but it is to be expected because we are including only the power index here and not the noise factor. So the difference between the mismatch and power indices is really not empirical. They're very, very similar. They're predicting the same thing with almost the same accuracy. The main difference is theoretical. So this is kind of back to the different cosmologies, the geocentric view relative to the sort of Copernican cosmology. The issue here is interpretation. So let's begin with the two issues I raised first, the issue of irrationality and the issue of risk and return. If capitalists and analysts are perfectly rational and they are fully prescient, then the Hussmann valuation index would be a straight line around 100. So this is what a perfectly matched world should look like. But if you count here the observations on the power index, and remember the power index is perfectly correlated or almost perfectly correlated with the mismatch index. So when we talk about the power index here, we are talking also about the mismatch index. So most of the time, there is a mismatch rather than a match. So most of the time, the world behaves in a way different than it should behave, right? And the interesting thing is that most of the explanations for this irrationality of capitalists is something to do with power, asymmetric information, government intervention, market imperfections, and so on and so forth. So the mainstream view usually speaks about utility, productivity, and so on, but eventually, when it comes down to explaining the world, most of the time, I counted here, only 15% of the observation are 100, so 85% of the observations are explained by power. They explain it by power. So if this is the case, if the world 85% of the time deviates from the model, and the deviation is explained by power, shouldn't we have a power model of the world as opposed to a utility or productivity model of the world? Probably, I think we should. So if we focus on power instead of a mismatch, then there is nothing to match, nothing to mismatch, and we can focus directly on what drives power. What's the nature of this power? So that's one observation that I'd like to start with. The second one is, about risk and return. Again, according to the annals of finance, risk and return should be positively correlated, but here we see that they are negatively correlated. I've already gone through this argument. So from a power perspective, this negative correlation between risk and return is not surprising at all. From a mismatch perspective, it is surprising, but here it's not surprising. And why is it not surprising? Because power is always exercised through some form of sabotage or the threat of sabotage. And sabotage elicits resistance to it in some form or another. And secondly, the greater the power in sabotage, usually the greater the resistance. So if you pull a string, it becomes much harder the farther you pull its sides apart. So everything else remaining the same, if capitalists are here when the power index is very low, it is much easier to increase this power further. But if capitalists are here, it is much more difficult to increase power further. And it is this kind of built-in resistance that almost ascertains the mean reversion of the index. And the mean reversion ascertains, essentially, that there will be a negative correlation between current valuations or current power index and future returns. In fact, it seems that two standard deviations are more or less the historical asymptote. That goes back to your question of whether I still ascribe to the asymptote model. Well, perhaps yes, because historically it seems that there is a clear asymptote here, and the power index never seemed to exceed that asymptote for more than a short while. And we can see that, say, in the 20th century, every time we reach that asymptote, so in the beginning of the 20th century and then in the beginning of the 21st century, there followed a massive reversal in the form of a major bear market. In other words, when capitalists approach this apparent asymptote and peak power, they have a good reason to fear their own power. Because as their power increases, we, based on the idea of resistance to power, expect some sort of a reversal. And here we come to the second aspect of the model, which is the concept of systemic fear. All right. So 7 years ago, in the midst of the financial crisis, we wrote a paper in which we argued that capitalists were struck by systemic fear, and that they were apprehensive not about profits falling or about interest rates rising, some sort of ephemeral movement. They were very concerned about the existence of the system as they knew it. And we also argued that this systemic fear could be identified empirically by looking at the co-movement of stock prices and current profit. I was sitting in the same chair making that argument, and people here were flabbergasted. Now, the room was full, not like today. Now, the logic back then was as follows. Capitalization is forward-looking, and it discounts not current profits, but the profits that will be earned in the future all the way to eternity. Now, in this scheme of things, current variations of profits have no more than a negligible effect on capitalization, because we look into the deep future. And if you revisit equation 2 on page 9 of your handout, you see that current profits do not even appear in the equation. We are concerned with the share of profit in income on average over the period all the way to infinity. We're not concerned with current variations. So it's nowhere really in the model. Now, this ritualistic reliance on the future implies, in our opinion, some form of systemic confidence. It implies that capitalists believe that the system is eternal and that the operational symbol of capitalization will exist forever. In other words, that earnings will continue to be earned and that assets will remain vendable till the end of times. Perhaps not in their hands, but in principle, there will always be earnings to be made, and there will always be somebody to sell your assets to. Within this systemic confidence, in the deep future, the ephemeral ups and downs of profits are really immaterial. Now, that's the conventional creed, and that's the conventional ritual that has taken over the world. Now, let's imagine the very opposite situation. So let's assume that capitalists lose their systemic confidence, and they are struck instead by systemic fear. So let's just kind of go through the motions here. Let's assume that they start to hesitate. So what happens? What happens when the power index that I showed you earlier is at an all-time high, and capitalists become apprehensive that the current power architecture is kind of vibrating and perhaps it's unsustainable? What happens when the chief promoters of globalization, namely the IMF, McKinsey, and other such organizations, throw in the towel and say, globalization doesn't work? These are the proponents of globalization. They're not some critics. What happens when peripheral states start to disintegrate and orbit out or flow out of the orbit of superpowers? What happens when domestic policymakers appear confused, if not clueless, about what is going on? What happens when inequality becomes center stage and reaches historical extremes, and the underlying population becomes aware of the situation, this differential situation, and kind of simmering with discontent? When the ecology seems to destabilize, when resource extraction seems to be reaching some sort of limits. The result of these kind of developments is what we call systemic fear. Now, the immediate reaction to systemic fear is not disintegration, it's denial. What? We, capitalists, fear about the system? No way. We're not fearful about the system. It's just kind of a natural reaction of rulers that they have no fear. This is what they tell to themselves. But in order to hold on to your confidence, you need another set of evidence, as opposed to your belief in the future. And the most important evidence, I think, is current profit. If current profit remains high, or better still, if current profit continues to rise, then the capitalist, we the capitalists, can remain confident and even hopeful. And if current profit continues to rise, we will not only hold on to our assets rather than sell them, we might actually buy more. And that's what you see now in the stock market. It's still kind of tittering, and there's kind of it goes up higher and higher. In other words, the immediate evidence for systemic fear lies in its very denial. So we can know that capitalists have been struck by systemic fear by the very fact that they negate and abandon their core ritual of forward-looking capitalization, and we can know the extent to which they negate and abandon this core ritual by the degree to which their asset prices reflect current profits. Now, in 2009, we used this idea of proof by negation to argue that there were two periods during which capitalists were struck by systemic fear, the 1930s and the 2000s. Now, unfortunately, our method was not very rigorous, to say the least, and it got us into some real trouble. First, we made a serious empirical mistake, mistake of negligence, I would say. And secondly, we got into a very intimidating debate with Andrew Kleeman on the page of the Journal of Critical Globalization Studies. So, you know, if you're not careful, you can get into trouble when you do empirical research. If you don't do empirical research, there's no such problem. So how do we do things differently now? Well, first, we look not at rates of change as we did in 2009, but at levels. And the reason is when you measure correlations, correlations already try to measure changes. So if you already look at rates of change, you're essentially measuring the second derivative instead of the first derivative. So that's the first correction that we introduced. The second one is that we shortened the window of comparison. In 2009, we looked at the three-year correlation, and that's way too long for capitalists who are short-sighted. So here we narrow the window to only 12 months. And third and finally, we take the advice of Ulf Martin here, who a few years ago went ahead and suggested that instead of eyeballing the correlation, we actually measure it. So we take a moving correlation over the entire data set. So let's see how we incorporate those modifications and how they pan out in the next chart. I hope you don't get chart sickness. So here again, we have two panels. And the top panel simply shows you the normalized monthly data for the price of the S&P 500 and for earnings per share, which we denote by EPS for short. And the bottom part of the panel shows you data on short-term correlations. So there is a thin series and a thick series. And the thin series you might not be able to see very well, but you will see it much better on your handout or perhaps on the PDF. And the thin series simply indicates the following. If you take any observation on that series, it is the value of the 12-month correlation between the top two series. So if I were to take January of 1980, say here, that would be the correlation between January 79 to January 80 between price and EPS. And you can see that the series correlates between plus one and minus one, but it is very volatile. It oscillates very hectically. So it's very difficult to eyeball the series. So what we do essentially is we take a 10-year trailing average of the 12-month trailing correlation. If you stop to think about it, it's just two mathematical operations. It's not very difficult, but the name sounds quite complex. And it's not. So we call this index in blue here, which is the 10-year trailing correlation, trailing average of the 12-month moving correlation, we call it the systemic fear index. And of course, this is quite difficult to see. And the reason it's there is to just explain the derivation. We can move to the next figure, figure 8, which simply takes the bottom of the chart, erases the monthly observations, and stays only with the 10-year trailing average, which is our systemic fear index. So we see here two patterns I'd like to draw attention to. One is a V-shape pattern, and the other is a short-term pattern of oscillations. So let's just kind of describe these two patterns. First, the long-term pattern. So we see that in the early 20th century, the value of our systemic fear index, and remember what it measures essentially is correlation, short-term correlation between price and current earnings, was very high. And why is that? Well, the capitalization ritual was just making inroads. We're talking early 20th century. Fisher is just writing in 1900. This is kind of on the radar screen of only a few capitalists, kind of the more kind of forward-looking type of visualize what is to be to happen, and they could take advantage of it. But the majority of the capitalists are still very much anchored in the present, so the correlation is very high. But that correlation is trending downwards. And essentially, by the early 1940s, sorry, late 40s, early 50s, capitalization makes its way into textbooks, and everybody starts to incorporate it. And the correlation starts to oscillate around zero. There's no correlation between current earnings and prices. Capitalists are not very fearful of the future, of the present, and certainly not of the future. They look into the deep future. So fear is declining dramatically over that century, and it's reaching something that is akin to no correlation between price and current earnings. Then, there are ups and downs. We'll come to them in a moment. In the early 1990s, we see an increase in the correlation. And initially, it seems like one of those oscillations. But by the early 2000s, it seems that something new is happening. And there is kind of the index goes vertical. And by the turn of the 21st century, it reaches an all-time high of 0.6. So most capitalists are now very focused on current earnings as opposed to the deep future. So So there's this V-shaped pattern. There's also a short-term pattern of fluctuations, which is important. And I think the next stage, having discovered this kind of relationship, is to ask why. Why is this happening? Why is this V-shaped pattern, and why the oscillations? So this leads us to figure 9. And as you can realize, we are heading deeper and deeper into speculative territory, but it's interesting speculations because they seem to reveal to us all sorts of regularities that we didn't envisage, and they are quite surprising. So this figure 9, tries to speculate on why the systemic fear index has the pattern that it has. So the systemic fear index is plotted against the right-hand scale, and it's the dotted blue line. And we superimposed on it the power index from earlier charts, but the only difference is that we don't look at the actual value of the power index, but on its 10-year trailing average. So we have the same kind of periodicity for the two indices. Now, the fascinating thing about this chart, I think, is that it shows a very tight correlation between the two indices. The power index and the systemic fear index are very tightly correlated over the past 132 years. The correlation is plus 0.83 out of a maximum of 1. Now, the conventional mismatch dogma has nothing to say about this relationship that I can think of, because why would the correlation between earnings, current earnings, and price change along with valuation? Why? I cannot think of any answer, but maybe there is. If you can raise one, I'll gladly consider it. I cannot see any obvious explanation from a mainstream perspective. But from a power perspective, I think that there could be a dialectical explanation to it. When power is very low, so for example, we're talking 1940s or 1980s, capitalists stick to the capitalization ritual. And the reason we speculate is that power can be significantly increased from that low level. So you can further redistribute income in favor of profit. You can further increase hype. You can further reduce profit volatility. You can further lower the normal rate of return. All of those things can be augmented relative to the current level in order to further amplify capitalization. Now, this potential for more power in the future allows capitalists to focus on the promising future and ignore the dismal present. And under those circumstances, the correlation between current prices and current earnings could be very low, could be zero, could be even negative, because they focus on the future. The future is promising. But when capitalized power is very high, so when we are here or here, the story is exactly the opposite. Capitalists are more or less forced to abandon forward-looking capitalization in these situations, because the future seems very much not favorable. Increasing power further under the circumstances seems almost impossible with the existing confines of the symbolic machine, as Ulf Martin calls it. The profit share and hype are already very high. Income volatility and the normal rate of return are already very low. So to further bolster those magnitudes of capitalization requires much more sabotage, and that means making the system more complex, making it sprawl further and further, and therefore making it more prone to breakdown. And when the system grows ever more brittle, capitalists lose their systemic confidence in the obedience of things, as Troy Cochran calls it. And the thing here is the essentially symbolic machine as a whole. It is the capitalist mode of power as a whole. So we can say, perhaps, that power and systemic fear, or the power index and our systemic fear index, tell us two related things about confidence in obedience. The power index tells us the degree of confidence in obedience, and the systemic fear index tells us the temporal basis on which this confidence rests. When power is low, confidence in obedience relies on the future. So capitalization is forward-looking. When power is high, by contrast, confidence in obedience relies reluctantly on the present. So there's a shift from forward-looking capitalization into present-looking capitalization, essentially a breakdown of the capitalization ritual. Now, based on this dialectical relationship, we can draw an interesting, I think, historical hypothesis and perhaps raise a question. So the historical hypothesis is that the acceptance of the capitalization model, in other words, the decline of the correlation between prices and current earnings all the way down to zero and even beyond, has to do with the century-long decline in capitalized power. That facilitated, in the minds of capitalists, the looking into the future. And perhaps the rise in capitalized power over the past 20 or 30 years shows us kind of the limits of the capitalization ritual. We're running against some limits of that ritual. Now, the question that arises from this is, before we can even begin to speculate on the substance of this hypothesis, is, again, what drives this pattern that we see here? What causes this thing to go down and then to go up, and what happens behind these oscillations? And here we come to the third aspect of our triangular model, namely strategic sabotage. So in what follows, I'll argue that capitalized power and systemic fear are both driven by strategic sabotage. Now, it's perhaps needless to say that this claim is diametrically opposed to the mismatch thesis and the conventional creed of political economy, both left and right. The dominant view is that financial markets oscillate around their economic fundamentals, and that the oscillation is pro-cyclical. What that means is that the stronger the fundamentals, the greater the optimism. And the greater the optimism, the greater the overshooting of the markets relative to the fundamentals. And conversely, the worse the fundamentals, the weaker the economy, the deeper the pessimism, and therefore the greater the undershooting of valuations. So this is why people say that bubbles inflate when the economy is good, when the economy is booming, it gets to extremes, and then they deflate when the economy tanks. That's kind of the conventional view. Now, we have already questioned this view on a number of occasions. First, in figure 9 that I showed you earlier, it is clear that market capitalization oscillates together with profits, together with the fundamentals or an aspect of the fundamentals, only when the market is very expensive. When the market is moderately expensive or very cheap, there's no connection with the fundamentals. So that's the first thing that we see here. In an earlier paper that we wrote about the mismatch thesis, we compared the magnitudes of so-called real capital stock and the magnitude of capitalization, and we took the rates of change and we compared, and it looked as if capitalization grows inversely with the underlying capital stock. So again, it's questioning the fundamental notion that markets are somehow pro-cyclical. Now, what I'd like to argue now is that this counter movement of the market against the fundamentals is now coincidence. The stock market essentially reflects the sabotage underpinnings of accumulation. And this is what we need to sort of model. So let's look at equation 10. And we're getting deeper and deeper into kind of speculative thinking here and speculative empirical work. So I'm not going to stick my neck on these charts, but I find them actually quite intriguing. This figure shows you the power index on the left, again, smoother 10-year trading average. And it superimposes on it a measure that we call strategic sabotage, and in a moment I'll explain what it is, strategic sabotage, but what it measures essentially is the annual growth rate of employment smooth as 10-year trailing average. So each observation shows you the annual growth of employment over the past 10 years on average. Furthermore, this strategic sabotage index is lagged 5 years. What that means is that if we find some regularity here, it means that the employment growth index is a leading indicator or a predictor of the power index in some sense. Now, why do we focus on employment growth? One important reason is because this indicator is a good proxy for both the mismatch and power perspectives of valuation. From a mismatch point of view, employment growth is a direct broad measure of economic activity. And from a power perspective, it's a broad inverse proxy of strategic sabotage. And why is that? Because employment growth is one of the most crucial metrics for both the well-being and the sense of security of the underlying population. Even in countries that have unemployment insurance and welfare payments and so on, the most scary thing is being laid off. So this is still a very important indicator. And of course, this is not a Marxist indicator because we're not interested here in production. We're interested in essentially in the existence of the underlying population and its relative sense of security. So the undermining of employment growth is akin, essentially, of strategically sabotaging the underlying population. Now, the thing that jumps out of the chart, at least in our eyes, is the remarkable 1939 reversal of the relationship between the two indices. Until 1939, employment growth and the power index were positively correlated. And then, as if somebody switched the social current from plus to minus, the relationship inverted, like in 1 year, suddenly. It's like the collapse of the Gulf Stream or something like that. You know, suddenly, England goes minus 30 Celsius. Now, how can such an overnight reversal even possible in a broad social phenomenon like that? Now, the answer to this question, I suspect, requires much more research that we did not even begin to conduct. But let me try to outline one initial hypothesis that we have here. And the 1930s experienced a major bear market that was ultimately resolved by creordering the entire mode of power. And the chief hallmark of this creordering, we know what it was. It was the rise of Keynesianism and the emergence of the welfare-warfare state. Now, one of the key pillars of Keynesianism was discretionary, counter-cyclical policy, and specifically for our purpose here, counter-cyclical monetary policy. And it is this sudden shift towards discretionary, counter-cyclical monetary policy that might explain this inversion of the relationship between capitalized power and strategic sabotage. So let's consider this hypothesis a bit further. Until 1939, the power and strategic sabotage indices were both very high and therefore positively correlated for two reasons. First, capitalized power and systemic fear were very high, so changes in stock prices move closely with changes in current earnings, and therefore with changes in employment, because employment and earnings are positively correlated in absolute terms. So this correlation is not that surprising, actually, given the high value of the power index. And secondly, there was no counter-cyclical monetary policy to spoil this equation, to affect the rate of interest, to which I'll come in a moment. So the correlation there makes, in our opinion, quite a bit of sense. Now, after 1939, though, capitalists started to expect government policy to counteract the cycle, in part through counter-cyclical monetary policy. And since the cycle is dominated by employment growth, or at least that's kind of a central element of it, they expected higher employment growth to bring about higher interest rates and therefore lower capitalization. We know the interest rates, when it rises, it undermines capitalization. Now, this expectation took some time to materialize, but if you look at the next chart, figure 11, you see that eventually, in the middle of, or from the middle of the 20th century onwards, from the early 60s, it actually became self-fulfilling. What the chart here shows you is the annual growth rate of employment, which is our strategic sabotage index, and superimposed on it is the yield on 10-year government bonds that is correlated with monetary policy. And what you see is that since the beginning of the 60s, there's a very tight correlation between them, almost 0.9%, where there was no correlation practically prior to that. Now, in 1943, Michael Kaletsky wrote an important article in which he identified what he called the political business cycle. He argued that the business cycle, as we know it, had been deeply politicized in more than one way and was now increasingly driven by government policy. And one of the key points that Kaletsky made was that expansionary monetary policy boosts employment and wages, because it boosts the economy, quote unquote, but it also boosts profit. So in this sense, it served economic interests of both workers and capitalists. But, and this is an important but, the efficacy of such policies demonstrated that governments can actually replace capitalists in generating prosperity, and it can replace government in actually maintaining prosperity. And this demonstration undermined the long-term political interests of capitalists. So although they benefited from government policy, economically, politically, it endangered them. And his claim was that in liberal economies, this contradiction between economic and political interests of capitalists meant that when it came to maintaining full employment, capitalists will almost always sacrifice their economic interest in favor of their political interest. They will sacrifice higher profits in order to remain in the driver's seat. So they will not tolerate expansionary policy forever. However, and here we come back to our own model, if we think of capital accumulation not as an economic activity, but as a form of capitalized power, then there is no sacrifice at all here. The consequence of tighter policy may be lower employment growth and lower profits here and now, but these short-term consequences in general have little bearing on forward-looking capitalization, insofar as capitalists exercise forward-looking capitalization. At the same time, where the immediate consequences of the policy in terms of employment and profits have little bearing on capitalization, the tool that the policy uses, and in particularly the rate of interest, has an enormous impact on capitalization. So the consequences are not that important here and now, but the tool is very important. And that is illustrated in what is illustrated in figure 10 and 11 is that intensified sabotage in the form of lower employment growth has become a leading indicator for lower interest rates down the road, and therefore lower interest rates are something that guarantees everything else remaining the same, higher capitalization. So what we end up here is not a narrow political business cycle a la Kaletsky, but we are ending here with a broader CASP policy cycle, what we tentatively call. In this setup, the government is not some sort of an exogenous element, but it is rather part and parcel of the capitalization of power and the regulation of sabotage in society. Moreover, the capitalists are much more single-minded about what goes on. They have no longer a conflict between their so-called political and economic interests in their head. Higher sabotage keeps capitalists in the political driver's seat, and while that sabotage might undermine their profits here and now, it allows lower interest rates. And lower interest rates have much greater impact on capitalization than lower earnings here and now. So as far as they're concerned, their political interests and the economic interests are really identical here. Now, in order to close the triangle here, this is the last chart I'm going to show you. This chart essentially brings together systemic fear and strategic sabotage. So the systemic fear index is the same as before. The strategic sabotage is plotted here, but inverted. And I inverted it in order to show you the correlation between the two series. And we already know that the higher the sabotage, the higher the subsequent capitalized power. But as I suggested, and I think there is some truth to it, strategic sabotage elicits resistance. And resistance raises eventually systemic fear in capitalists. And therefore, we would expect to see what we see in the figure here, that the higher the strategic sabotage, the greater the systemic fear. So let me conclude. We started with the conventional creed of the mismatch thesis, which assumed that capitalists constantly try to price the underlying economic fundamentals, that they rarely, if ever, succeed in doing so, and thirdly, that their failure is the best predictor of future returns. So that these are the three sort of features of the conventional mismatch thesis. We then proceeded to take this cosmology and put it on its feet as we see it. And we outlined a triangular CasP model of the stock market that demonstrated three claims. First, we argued that the mismatch valuation indicators are in fact driven not by economic productivity or utility, but they're driven by capitalized power. Secondly, that capitalized power is dialectically intertwined with systemic fear. So they go hand in hand, actually. It's not intuitive, but you think about it, it begins to kind of resonate when you think about it a little bit more. And thirdly, that both capitalized power and systemic fear are driven and dependent on strategic sabotage. Now, an interesting and important derivative, perhaps, of this model is the notion of a CasP policy cycle, the idea that government policy, insofar as it increasingly caters to the imperatives of capitalized power, favors lower employment growth in order to enable lower rates of interest. And that observation, and I'm just about the final leg of the argument, so another minute, leads us to the current moment. We've already seen that the current readings of both the mismatch and power indicator, just to remind you, they're not different empirically, they're different in their interpretation. They both suggest that winter is coming and that a new major bear market is in the offing, very likely, and that if history repeats itself here, getting out of this major bear market might require a major creodering of capitalism as it did in the past. Now, we are not there yet, so I'm not in no position to kind of really start speculate second, third degree and so on historically. But for the time being, perhaps one suggestion is not to expect any progressive shift in government policy, particularly not in the United States. Policymakers there are really keen on marking time by keeping employment growth dead in the water. Because if they fail to do that, and if employment growth rises, you can imagine the pressure put on the central bank to start raising interest rates, and that will eventually guarantee a triggering of the next major bear market. Okay, thank you. I'll stop here.
Thank you, Jonathan. And okay, the question, the mic is open to floor, so anyone has question or comment? Okay.
Okay, this is very rapidly improvised on the hoof response. To figure eight.
Figure eight.
Yeah, figure eight and nine. Systemic fear index. You explained the kind of uptick in the fear index from...
Figure eight, you said.
Yeah, yeah. So you can look at figure nine as well. Actually, might be more useful.
You want nine?
Or? Nine, yeah.
Nine
might be more useful. So you explained the uptick from about 1990 in the systemic fear index. As the kind of no future for the capitalist and a kind of freak out about
maybe from the 2000.
Okay, because yeah, you're not sure whether that first leg of the cycle is a continuation of what's happening from 1950 or so, right? Oscillating around zero. But I was thinking about alternative explanations for the sellout at that point.
Right.
And there's a move around that time with the emergence of an explicit doctrine of neoliberalism of the activist shareholder. So the shareholder goes from somebody who invests in industry and the corporation for long-term gains to short-term returns and becomes a speculator rather than an investor. And if you take that model, there's a sense in which the shareholder is somebody who's interested just in a short-term profiteering without an interest in the long-term growth of the company or the corporation, which is then left to fend for itself. At the same time, because the shareholder is extracting profits from the company, the company puts the pressure on the worker and also involves layoffs to increase efficiencies. So I wonder if that acts as an alternative explanation, both. I'm not sure about the lag, because I'm just sort of trying to think it out.
Yeah, well, here there's no lag.
Oh, okay, all right, so this is...
Here there's no lag.
Okay, all right. So yeah, it would be wage rate against S&P 500, right?
Right.
So the share price would rise, because that's what the shareholder wants, puts pressure on the company in order to make sure they can extract by selling or taking dividends and so on. The wage rate has to be repressed in order to kind of increase profiteering within the corporation, at the cost of investment, which is also the fear index, because it's you're not investing in the company for its industrial future. You're investing essentially as a derivative product. So I just wonder if that could be a counter explanation. I mean, the move from like the industrial period essentially to the swing into the post-industrial. You imagine the shareholder to be interested in long-term production and sort of long-term gains and so on and so forth.
Well, remember, investors are not interested in profits. They're interested in the value of their shares. And profit is presumably something that determines the value of the shares. So, current profits are important only insofar as investors are convinced that these profits will actually determine prices. And whenever you buy a share, you need to assume that everybody else is thinking like you, or that you know what everybody else is thinking and maybe acting contrarianly and so on. So you need to constantly think of what other people are thinking or other investors are thinking. And what you're suggesting here is that for some reason, capitalists have changed their view, namely that if I can increase profits now, this is the only thing that counts, and I will still be able to sell it, even though the companies are essentially bleeding themselves dry. And from my reading of the view of capitalists on that type of strategy, this is not, as I read it, what they have in mind. They see the kind of this drive for current profitability as the kind of the constant watch, as opposed to the bleeding dry. So if we are constantly trying to get as much profit as we can, that is in fact the best guarantor of the fact that this company is going to last forever. So a company like General Electric is a company that is keen on, say, operating in markets in which it has either the first or second position, and it's going to be the most powerful or the second more powerful, and it guarantees not only very high returns, very high profitability, but it guarantees tremendous stability, in fact, despite the fact that it's currently watching its profitability. So I'm not sure I accept the fact that investors actually see the future of capitalism as being a doomsday scenario, and they accept actually that this doomsday, because that's what is implied by what you're saying, that they are recognizing that they are bleeding their companies, and nevertheless, what counts is just the present. I don't think that
it's not that they see a doomsday scenario, but the move is from an investor as an investor in the long-term profitability, as you're saying, in order to maintain the company as a long-term revenue stream, essentially, to something more like a hedge fund model of investment, which is essentially speculation. So the interest is not in what the company will do long-term, where the profits, but it's to play the market as a whole, maybe wreck a company in order to kind of move out.
Okay.
And then you move those profits into another set of investments. Well, and that happens from about the 90s onwards, right?
Well, I mean, the cause and effect here, first of all, are kind of questionable. You know, what causes what? I would argue kind of the first iteration, it's just off the top of my head, is that as capitalized power increased, the view that current profits are more important is actually the result rather than the cause. So that's one interpretation. But I think that there's something else. And this is an issue that is actually quite recognized in valuation analysis, is that there are two types of investors. The value investors that actually take a long-term view, and therefore they're asking, is this company cheap or expensive relative to the deep future? So these are value investors, and they will buy companies that are undervalued with the anticipation that the market is self-correcting, and therefore they'll make a bundle. And then there are all other investors that have no interest in valuation, and that they are just thinking either technically, or they're thinking following much shorter spends. They say they are momentum investors. So they don't care about valuation. They care about the short-term momentum of the market, and there are algorithm funds and so on that they can, you know, make a fraction of a return every day and end up with 10 years of positive returns. You know, they have no interest in valuation. But the argument, and I think it's probably a valued argument, is that the big moves on the market, those kind of moves that we see here over a long period of time, are really driven not by speculators, not by momentum investors, but they're driven by the mismatch model. So I don't think that the view of the market as kind of a shift towards short-term returns is actually a cause of that. I think it's just a consequence of that. And fundamentally, investors have to believe, even the technical investors, that somehow there will be a market down the road. Because otherwise, if everybody believes that capitalization is dead, then everybody will tank and dump their holdings. So they must believe that, I mean, technically speaking, or even I would say theoretically, from a theoretical perspective, you can't have a situation in which everybody is thinking just short term. You must have a belief that some investors think long-term. Otherwise, there's no support to that short-term thinking. But, you know, this requires, I think, longer-term or more thinking to formulate kind of all of those possible holes that are evident in that question. I didn't raise this issue, and I really didn't think about it up until now. So this remains still a very much a skeleton in terms of our argument. But I think that your proposition seems to me that the immediate answer would be that short-term thinking is a consequence rather than a cause. And deeper than that, I don't think that this fundamental view of the future actually has changed. So a fundamentalist view of the market as self-correcting relative to fundamentals is something that is acceptable, I think, among all investors, even though many of them might act momentarily because that's more profitable to do.
Okay. So next person. Okay.
Thanks, Jonathan. That's fascinating stuff and lots of questions. What came to mind for me, and I have a number of questions, but this is the one I'll raise, is before we get the capitalized earning model, we have the hard asset model and the dividend yield model. And that's kind of how we're valuing firms for most of the 20th century until there's an accountancy change that happens in 1990. And that's when the capitalized earning model actually in accounting forces firms and forces investors to value the firm in the future. And that becomes normalized at this point. So of course capitalization is happening before this, but it's not the capitalized earning model that they're using. They're using either hard assets, that is say firm's value has something to do with the actual physical assets it has, or the dividend yield, that is say, are we meeting kind of expectations in dividends, right? So there's something that goes on there in the 1990s in accounting that changes everything. And I think you can see it if you look at market capitalization, it goes off the charts in 1990. Now you can't really see it on the one graph that you have, which is I think figure five. And let me go see it. No, figure three, US-based non-financial corporations. And you've got it logged. But if you didn't actually log it, you would see this spike go off in the 1990s incredibly. So that kind of shows the correlation or with the kind of accounting.
This one?
Figure three. You have it there? So that's US-based non-financial corporations?
Right.
So you've got it logged, but if you didn't log it, you'd actually see this giant spike in market capitalization from 1990, and that's with the accounting change. Now, eventually, of course, other stock markets start to adopt this, and under the World Federation of Exchanges, that's the top 55 exchanges across the world, it's all regularized by the capitalized earning model. My kind of question, I guess, to you is about limits, because with the hard asset model and the dividend yield model, there were actual limits, right? Because obviously you're valuing the firm based on its assets. It can only have so many assets and so on and so forth. Same thing with the kind of dividend yield model, which was less popular, but nonetheless, still there were limits to it, right? How much do you earn? And then on top of this, you know, what dividend will you actually pay out and so on. But with the capitalized earning model, there appears to be no limits. Right? So Apple's value, who knows? It could be the first $1 trillion company, right? And you've pointed out this before in your research earlier, right? That the capitalization of a firm, what investors think it's worth, has really nothing to do with its hardcore physical assets or the number of its employees. It has something to do with it, of course. You need assets of some kind and you need employees of some kind. But, you know, there's no telling what, you know, mix will yield what level of capitalization. So my question to you, and I'm sorry I'm getting a little bit long-winded, is if you look at the global financial crisis, at the tip of the rising capitalization, global capitalization, so not the US, global, so that's the 55 stock markets listed by the World Federation of Exchanges, we have about $62 trillion around the top of 2007. Global financial crisis hits, you know, systematic fear, whatever you want to call it, and we get down to about $30 trillion in world stock market capitalization. So a drop in by about half, a little over half in stock market capitalization. Now it took the whole 20th century, and really that turn in the 1990s in accounting, to get to that level, to $62 trillion in stock market capitalization. It took 1 year to cut the value of all those firms in half, okay? Then, all of a sudden now, if you look at worldwide capitalization, from 2008, the bottom of the crisis, all of a sudden to today, it's about $72 trillion. Again, total world stock market capitalization. So whilst we could say, you know, it took all the 20th century to get to $62 trillion in capitalization, we lost half that value, and then now we're back up at $72 trillion. So the question is, I don't think there really necessarily are limits to the capitalized earning model. And I wonder if you have any thoughts about that. Thanks.
Okay. First of all, changes in accounting usually validate changes that are already happening. So for instance, the argument that Fisher made at the turn of the century about capitalization is an argument that is made because some financiers and investors already think in that way, and it gives a theory for it. In the 50s, the idea of financialization already makes itself, or it makes its way into textbooks. That means that capitalization is already kind of a way of thinking about and acting about markets. So I do not think in general that these accounting changes in the 1990s have sort of initiated a transformation. They were perhaps just signifying a transformation that was already happening. Now, I also don't think that there is much difference between the dividend yield model and the more general view of capitalization of earnings, because dividends as a percentage of earnings is something that changes very slowly. So if you discount your dividends and or if you discount your future earnings, you are essentially discounting different magnitudes, but the movement of those magnitudes are more or less the same. So there is no difference here. And I also think that equity owners are not bounded by all those regulatory or sort of formal changes in accounting. They think about the world based on how kind of the operational symbolism sprawls. And I think that I don't think that there was a significant change in terms of the attitude of capitalist versus the capitalization formula in the 1990s. I think that capitalists have started to think about capitalization as the kind of the significant model already in the 1960s and 70s, because we already have those theories among economists that already reflect what is going on in the market in terms of capitalist capitalized asset pricing, etc. So my own opinion is that there was no fundamental change about how to discount the stock market, maybe how you are allowed to actually write asset prices in balance sheets and income statements. That's something that is regulated, but the way that capitalists actually approach their investments, I don't think that there was a significant change, at least as far as I know, and I'll be willing to discuss this further with you. Now, in terms of those drops that that you try to kind of dramatize here, if you look at the United States, and I don't think that the global stock market is very different in terms of the magnitudes involved, the drop in the last major bear market of 52% is by no means exceptional. In fact, at the turn of the 20th century, the drop was 70%. So this drop is actually kind of the lesser of the drops compared to previous major bear market. The only one that was smaller was in the 1835 to 42. So there's nothing really spectacular about the recent major bear market. These are all logarithmic scales, so the numbers here could be kind of misleading when you look just at the visuals. But in terms of grand crashes, there were significant ones before. The early 2000 are not really exceptional, I think.
But this is just the S&P 500.
Yeah, but...
So that's very, very limited, right? I mean, representative of the U.S. economy, surely.
Yeah, but... Yeah, I understand. But there, what you do is you combine different stock markets, and as time passes, you add more and more stock markets. So you are combining shift and share. You're combining the aggregate measure as well as the average measure, and both of them contribute. So I have to see the numbers. But I think that the 50% drop in the financial literature is called run-of-the-mill, crisis. It's something that has happened already six times before. So it's nothing exceptional. I mean, the numbers tell us. Whether this is globally exceptional or not, well, I have to see the numbers.
Okay, time is running out, but considering the significance of Jonathan's presentation, if there is anyone who would die for asking the question, so you die. All right. So go ahead. Sorry.
All right, thank you. I thought that was very interesting, but it leads me to ask whether you have performed some kind of very fundamental paradigm shift there since the book came out in terms of both power and sabotage, since the original seemed to be a dominant capital over capital, both in terms of the accumulation process and how you measure power and how that develops over time. Whereas this, with the wage rate and all that kind of stuff, seems to go into more traditional capital-labor relationship. Can you elaborate on that, maybe?
The first thing I'd like to say is that you should probably, as far as we're concerned, drop the term paradigm. So there's no paradigm shift because there was no paradigm to start with. We try to stay away from paradigms, and once people start treating what we do as paradigm, we probably should look for another job. So I like to think about what we're doing as some form of sort of autonomous thinking about the world, and I'm very happy to be able to change my opinions and change my focus and so on. So the book from 2009 was no paradigm, and I have no problem, you know, discarding parts of it if I'm convinced that they are wrong. I mean, I'll be sad, but I will do that nonetheless. Now, one thing in the book in 2009 is, and our other work, is that we tend to be quite careful before making grand claims. We're always kind of very worried that we make nonsense claims. And therefore, we try to kind of back what we say with some evidence. And we did a lot of work about intercapitalist measures and so on. So we focused on that. But implicit in that work is the idea that power relations are seen more as a context, more as a web. Maybe a hierarchy. I don't know exactly what the best metaphor to use, but it's certainly not limited to relations between capitalists. This is part of the picture, but not the entire picture. And here, the initial step is to take a very broad brush view between the owners of capital and the rest of the population, because it seems that this is a useful starting point. Can we take this kind of perspective and refine it further with looking at individual groups within capital and how they relate to this kind of a broader model? Sure, it would be great to do that. But in this context, this seemed to be a convenient starting point. So I don't think we have any strong opinion on how this model can be changed and altered. It seems to be giving us insight into why some of the models of the mainstream seem to be so predictably powerful by going under the skin and saying, no, you are barking up the wrong tree. You're actually explaining something else. You're explaining power relations. Are these the only power relations that count? Probably not. So I accept that this is a diversion relative to some of the things we have done in the past, but not really that radical, because in our earlier work, we did look, when we were still students, for example, kind of a broad brush measures of power, not just within different groups in capital, because we didn't even have access to this information.
Okay, thank you. Then, thank you, Jonathan. And although Shimshon Bichler is not here, we should also send our thanks to him. And thank you, everybody.
Thank you.